Gospel comes from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 28, beginning at verse 1. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Alleluia! Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia! Alleluia. Continue with our first hymn.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
All praise to God the Father, who raised his Son in victory. All praise to Jesus, God's Son, risen from the dead, our living and reigning King. All praise to God the Holy Spirit, who has worked in us a living hope in the resurrection. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Let us confess our sins to God our Father and receive his forgiveness, that we may be reconciled to him and to one another. Merciful and risen Savior, we claim to be people of the resurrection, yet we confess that far too often we do not exhibit a resurrection life. Our prayers are weak and our faith is shallow. We compartmentalize our lives, placing you on the sidelines of our work, our family life, and our play. We take too much for granted and fail to thank you for the blessings of health, relationships, and freedoms. We fail to be good stewards of your creation, and we become discouraged by problems, limitations, and failures. Gracious and ever-present God, forgive our short-sightedness and our lack of trust. Help us to see that you are at work in our lives and in the world. Inspire us to hold fast to you in faith, knowing that you are working all things for good, and that because of the empty tomb, we have nothing to fear. Amen. Our living Lord and Savior forgives the most impossible sins, overcomes the greatest fears, comforts the loudest cries, and breaks down the strongest barriers to his love and peace. Through the resurrection, Christ's power and the Holy Spirit lives and works here and now. My friends, know that as God's own, we are forgiven, and be at peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Continue with our hymn of praise.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, the Father, through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, you have overcome death and opened the gate of everlasting life to us.
Grant that we, who celebrate with joy the day of our Lord's resurrection, may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Continue with God's word for this day.
Our first reading on this Easter morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 10, beginning in verse 34. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him to appear not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to judge, to be the judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Our second reading this Easter morning comes from Colossians chapter 3. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. She stroked her husband's cheek. It was a gentle touch, a touch of love. And she hummed quietly into his ear. She knew that it wouldn't be much longer. His breathing was heavy, and he was so restless, like a butterfly getting ready to come out of a cocoon.
And that's exactly what was happening. The man was getting ready to be born into a new and wonderful place. His children and grandchildren stood quietly in the corners of the room weeping. They didn't want him to go, and occasionally one would sob into a Kleenex. But the woman kept singing and whispering into the old man's ear and gently stroking his head. She loved him so much. She was almost like a midwife at his birth as she gently encouraged him. She told him it was all right for him to go, that they would all be okay, and not to worry about them. They'd all be together again in that heavenly house with many rooms. It was time, she said, time for him to go. She told him to look for his mom, his dad, his brother, and not to keep Jesus waiting, and to keep an eye out for her. She kissed him on the ear and said, "You better save me a place up there, and don't you ever forget how much I love you." And with that, he slipped away.
Over the next couple of days, family and friends arrived at the man's house and gathered around the kitchen table. They came to share their stories. They laughed and they cried. And over endless coffee, they remembered. They got out the family photo albums and passed them around. They laughed at the funny clothes and the long hair. They remembered family vacations and Christmases long ago. They remembered the special things about him, the things he did, the things he said. Someone would say something and that would trigger even more precious memories, like dominoes falling. Things that had been forgotten were remembered. 3 days after his death, they gathered in the church to find comfort in their sorrow. They gathered to give thanks to God for this man's life. And the pastor read the Easter story from Matthew, just like we did this morning. And he reminded them of the resurrection promise of life beyond life. And God was there with them. And he comforted them. Now, we Christians live in a tension, don't we? A tension between Good Friday and Easter. A Good Friday world is full of suffering and questioning, unfairness, troubles, mistakes, hurts, losses, and grief. Good Friday in the Christian faith is the day we commemorate God's suffering and death on the cross. It's a day to remember all Christ did that day, and that it was our sins he died there for. Our sins that drove each nail deeper into the rough-cut, blood-soaked wood he was pinned to. Today we come together again, this time to celebrate his resurrection in the empty tomb. Because we know that if the tomb they laid Jesus' body in couldn't hold him, the grave won't be able to hold us either. That there's a better place waiting, just beyond this one, just like he promised. It's a Good Friday world, filled with suffering and troubles and death. But we're Easter people. We're Easter people. If you remember just one thing this morning, remember that. It's a Good Friday world, but we're Easter people. It makes all the difference in how we approach day-to-day living. It makes all the difference in how we approach death. It makes all the difference in how we manage to live with death as an undeniable part of this life. The former director of the British Museum, Neil McGregor, wrote a book called The History of the World in 100 Objects. A man whose daily life was surrounded by objects of history, some on public display, but many thousands more in storage down in the bowels of the facility. He wondered if he could tell the history of the world by picking out just 100 of those artifacts. I imagine it was quite a challenge. He chose a mummy of a high priest from Egypt during the time of the biblical prophecies, and a stone chopping tool believed to be between 1.8 and 2 million years old. It's considered to be the oldest object that humans ever consciously made. A coin from 550 BC, and not just any coin. It was a coin of Croesus, the last king of Lydia, known for his vast wealth. He was defeated by Cyrus the Persian, a big part of our Old Testament history. And so it goes up through modern times. But noticeably missing are three things that influenced history like no others. Maybe because they weren't stored in his or any other museum. The cross, the tomb, and the stone that was rolled away by the angel to reveal the empty tomb of Jesus Christ. Without them, you're missing the most important chapter in the history of the world, aside maybe from creation. And like the 3 days Jesus' body, his dead body, lay in the tomb, they can't be separated. Without the cross, there is no tomb. Without the tomb, there is no stone. And without the stone, there's no resurrection. And without the resurrection, the Apostle Paul argues, we are of all people most to be pitied. 1 Corinthians 15. Without the tomb, the cross fades into nothing more than a hero story in which the hero is killed and evil wins. We spend a lot of time focusing on the cross because it was on that cross Jesus' own innocent shed blood was poured out to take away all our sins. But the tomb is also important to our faith because the tomb is where you put dead people, and Jesus was dead. That's not something to just skim over in our salvation story. He didn't faint. He didn't just appear to die and have a near-death experience like so many people who write books that make the bestseller list. The tomb is important because it meant Jesus died. And in Jesus' day, dead people were put into tombs. If he wasn't dead, then the cross is a sham and the resurrection a fable. But Jesus died. Dead like 3 days in the L.A. morgue, dead. You know, I suppose I think more about death the older I get, just like everybody else, I suppose. I know that unless Jesus returns first, I'll contract something or I'll develop something sooner or later that I won't recover from, even if it's just old age. I'm not afraid of dying. Like everyone else, I hope it doesn't hurt too much. But you know, even if it does, it'll be worth it just to get to the other side, because I sincerely believe, just like the Bible promises, that death is only a doorway I'll have to pass through to reach my real home in heaven. Just a doorway. On the other hand, I can't say I'm looking forward to it like on the next bus either. But maybe some of you are. You've raised your family. Your kids are launched and doing okay on their own. You've lived a pretty good life, and now that the issues and struggles of a long life have caught up with you, you're beginning to look forward to the next one. If you know Jesus, your risen Savior, you know that's okay. There's also the fact that, like many of you, I'm just too busy right now to fit it into my schedule. There's no time to die. It'd be too inconvenient. But then I hear the Easter story again, and I'm reminded that the real goal of my life is to die in Christ and be welcomed into my eternal home, the one already prepared for me. And I think, you know, how busy is too busy? God must get a real kick out of that one. And what a great story it is. Easter's like a bright light that cleaves the darkness of our Good Friday world. You know, that first Easter was some surprise, right? The women didn't go to the tomb to experience the resurrection. They'd gone hoping to finish preparing Jesus' body for its final rest. Unlike the Egyptians, who embalmed to preserve the body, the Jews anointed the body with perfumes and spices to mask the odor of decomposition. Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea had done what they could on Friday, but because under Jewish law, the body needed to be entombed before sundown, there hadn't been time to finish before the beginning of the Sabbath, when no work was to be done. The tomb would have been a chamber, really, hollowed out of solid rock with a shelf built on one side where the body could be laid. The doorway would have been closed with a very heavy circular stone that rolled down a slightly inclined a runway or a channel until it slammed into place, sealing the opening. The two men did what they could in the short time they had, wrapping Jesus' body in strips of linen interspersed with myrrh and aloes. And then the wedge holding that great stone door in place was kicked away, and the stone rolled home. According to Matthew and Mark, the stone was very large, while two ancient manuscripts add that 20 men could scarcely roll it. Now, how the women thought they could ever manage to get inside was a question they hadn't solved yet, but they knew they had to try. As they were making their way to his borrowed tomb, there was a great earthquake, and an angel of the Lord had descended and rolled back the stone and sat on it, waiting. His appearance was like lightning, Matthew tells us, his clothes as white as snow. The women went from perplexed to terrified in a New York minute. They weren't ready for Easter yet. They were still Good Friday believers. prepared to anoint the body, but not celebrate the resurrection. The angel tells them, don't be afraid. And he invites them to take a look inside for themselves. I know that you seek Jesus, he says, who was crucified. He's not here, for he has risen, just as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. The tomb was empty. As the women make their way back to tell the disciples the good news, Jesus makes a personal, unscheduled appearance. Greetings, he says. Can you even imagine? Greetings. The Bible tells us they took hold of his feet and they worshiped him. He tells them not to be afraid, but to go and tell the others that he'll meet them in Galilee. And just like that, their surprise and their sorrow turned to joy. Their Savior was alive. Their hope restored 100-fold. And not only his disciples, but more than 500 people would see Jesus alive before he returned to his Father in heaven. Now, was the story's ending a surprise to you? No? What, you've heard it before? I suppose it's good to know how the story ends because it fills us with hope. But even though it may have been something that lost its surprise for you, I pray that it will never lose its sense of wonder, because it truly is wonder-filled, wonderful. Maybe we can recover some of that wonder this morning. The kids still have it. Maybe that's why we like egg hunts so much, why the Easter Bunny got a special dispensation this year to make his rounds. We get to relive that sense of surprise and wonder through children. You know, but even we cynical old adults can recapture that wonderment. We can do it by remembering that once God had brought us to faith, we became Easter people in spite of living for now in a Good Friday world, a world Jesus has overcome for us. That's why our Easter faith isn't just something for Easter morning. We recapture that moment every time our faith helps us transcend our everyday troubles or even a once-in-a-lifetime pandemic. The tomb is empty. Jesus lives, and so will we one day, in a better place, a perfect place where death has been banished forever. The Good Friday world we live in for now is besieged with the specter of looming death, crushed hopes, dashed desires, devastated dreams. Good Friday was a day when everything seemed to be going wrong. Have you ever had a day like that? You know, one of those days when you just felt overwhelmed, holding on to your sanity by a thread, at the end of your rope? Haven't you had one of those days when you were ready to just chuck it all and give up? Well, to live as an Easter Christian means that we can live as hopeful people in what would otherwise seem like a hopeless world. You know, how much good news do you read in the papers these days or online? You know, how much good news do you see on TV? Not that much. For the most part, it's warnings and it's worries and it's hopelessness and political infighting and sniping. That's a Good Friday world. But we're not Good Friday believers. We're Easter people. And Easter is God's promise that he'll always be around, ready to roll back the stone from the door of the tomb for us to peek in one more time, to remind us that there really is hope in what often seems like a hopeless world. God is near. The empty tomb is God's way of showing us that, one, Jesus' Good Friday death was accepted as payment for all our sins, and two, that he has power even over death itself. Because Jesus lives, God goes with you, unseen, every single day. He's there even in the midst of your worst Good Friday moments. So just like that first Easter, don't be surprised if he shows up when you least expect it. All over the world today, people are gathering together digitally like this to remember and rejoice, to celebrate Jesus, the Son of God, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, our Savior and Redeemer, alive forevermore. And as we rejoice and lift our voices in song this morning, heaven sings and rejoices right along with us. even apart, we've come together as one in Christ. This is what it's all about, the Christian faith. People join together not just by their physical proximity, but by their common belief, by faith, that because Jesus lives, we shall live also. Death and the grave will have no more hold on us than it did on him. You know, by tonight, you'll be able to walk into Rite Aid's or Vaughn's and find chocolate Easter eggs marked at 50% off. By Tuesday, Easter merchandise will be slashed to 60% off. And by Friday, 70%, and beyond that, you'll probably find it in the dumpster. But while the culture, the Good Friday world, continues to discount and even dump Easter, we're called to take a different view. We're to take Easter into our hearts and make it part of our everyday living, because an Easter world is filled with joy. Christ's victory over sin and death is our victory. By faith in Jesus, our sins are forgiven. Our future in heaven is secured. And it just gets better from here. It's that kind of a wonderful, surprisingly good news day. Just when we need it most. Because Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And amen. And now may that very special peace of God that passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll take a moment now to confess our Christian faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
Please join with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Rejoicing that our Savior's tomb is empty, and that he swallowed up death forever, let us pray for the church of our risen Lord and for everyone in need. Lord of life, keep in faith all of us whom you have baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus. Drive sin out of our hearts. Strengthen us to resist the devil's temptations and fill us with Easter life, so that the world can see by our lives that you have given us life that lasts forever. In the name of our risen Lord, hear our prayer and give us his life. Lord of life, through your angels, you invited the women at Jesus' empty tomb to tell the disciples about his resurrection. Give us hearts so filled with thanks that we do not keep the good news to ourselves, but share it with the people in our lives and joyfully support the proclamation of the gospel all over the world. In the name of our risen Lord, hear our prayer and give us his life. Lord of life, guide the leaders of our land and the leaders of all countries. Give them your wisdom so that they use their authority to protect the helpless and care for all people. Bring an end to all hatred and war, and give to us concord and peace. Watch over those who serve in the military and their families. Keep them from harm, and give your comfort to those who must spend these holy days apart from those they love. In the name of our risen Lord,
hear
our prayer, and give us his life. Lord of life, you promise to wipe away tears from all faces. We beg you to be with the sick, the injured, the aged, and everyone in need. Give them the peace that comes from having resurrection life in Jesus. And if you know it to be best, grant them healing. In the name of our risen Lord, hear our prayer and grant us his life. Lord of life, we praise you for your care in our lives and the lives of the people we love. Make all marriages among us reflections of Christ's gracious love for his bride, the church. Bless our families with your affection and guidance. Watch over those who are out of work and provide for their needs as we share our blessings and our time, our treasures and our talents to help one another. In the name of our risen Lord,
please join with me now in the prayer our Lord Jesus himself taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Continue with our closing song.
Thanks for joining us for worship on this very special and maybe unusual, but Easter Sunday, but Easter's always a day to be remembered, a day we keep in our hearts. So God bless you and yours this day. Stay safe and be thankful for all God has done for you in Jesus Christ.